Thank you for joining us. I imagine some people might still be joining the call over the next few minutes. My name is Nima Rafiei. I am a master's student at the University of Chicago in the Center for Middle Eastern Studies and a board member with the Middle Eastern Studies Student Association. We're very happy that you're able to join us for our first guest lecture circuit for this winter quarter. I'm very happy, very honored to have Professor Abbas Milani from Stanford University join us. He graciously accepted our invitation to discuss a very insightful, very interesting topic that's very near and dear to our hearts on Persian poetry from Saadia Shirazi. Very quickly, Professor Abbas Milani is the Hamid and Christina Moghadam Director of Iranian Studies at Stanford University in California. He's one of the founding co-directors of the Iran Democracy Project and a research fellow at the Hoover Institution. His expertise is in U.S.-Iran relations, as well as Iranian cultural, political, social, and security issues. Until 1986, he taught at the Tehran University's Faculty of Law and Political Science, where he was also a member of the board of directors of the university's Center for International Relations. After moving to the United States, for 14 years, he was the chair of the political science department at the Notre Dame de Namur University. My apologies if I butchered the pronunciation of that. And for 8 years, additionally, he was also a visiting research fellow at the University of California, Berkeley's Middle East Center. Professor Milani this evening will be speaking about humanism in the poetical works of Saadia Shirazi, based on a book that he recently co-authored with Maryam Mirzadeh. Dr. Milani, thank you so much for joining us. We really appreciate it. I will turn it over to you.
Thank you very much for your very kind and generous introduction. It's a pleasure to be with you. I wish I could have been at the University of Chicago. University of Chicago, I think for every one who is interested in Iran, has a very dear and cherished place because of Professor Mayed, who was there, because of Professor Lewis, because of the tablets who are there, and the university has done a remarkable job of protecting them. Also individually for me, because of someone who's no longer at Chicago, Leszek Kolakowski, who was at Chicago, and I translated his three-volume masterpiece on the main currents of Marxism many, many, many years ago. So it is for me a very distinct pleasure to be talking with you. The subject of the talk, as was mentioned in that very generous introduction, is this book. It is in Persian. It is called Insan Garoyi Dar Saadi. I've co-authored it with Maryam Mirzadeh. The book was published in Iran about a year and a half ago. The publisher is Zemestan, who is the son of the great poet Ahavan Sales. Before this, they had essentially published the father's book, Ahavan Sales, and this was a foray into the work of someone else. I'm not going to give you a brief account of the book. I'm going to talk about some of the aspects of the book and some of the what I think are more important, sort of both theoretical and historical considerations for it. After I talk for about 40 minutes, 50 minutes max, hopefully we will engage in a conversation and I'll do my best to try to answer your questions. Much of what I have written in the last 30, 40 years has been around the central debate that I think defines Iranian cultural, political, in sense, economical history over the last century and a half. And that is the question of modernity or tajaddud. I have always, in these writings, been of the opinion that the common perception that we have that the debate on modernity and what is tajaddud begins only in late 19th century in Iran is a misconception. It is too Eurocentric. It affords almost a privileged position to Western Europe in the development of what we understand modernity to be. And there are, as Kolakowski, whose name I mentioned and has written a brilliant book on modernity, says, there are as many definitions of modernity as there are writers. But I think there are some commonalities about these definitions. And modernity essentially refers to a secular society, a rational society, a society given to humanitarian values, humanism, to be very specific, a society given to individualism, a society given to gender equality, a society given to the idea that religion is a private matter, you can do whatever you want in the privacy of your home. Modernity is about the rise of something called the private domain that is protected from the intrusions of the church, the mosque, the temple, the state, the police, where you have a domain all to yourself. And as one of our past colleagues argued, one of the definitions of a democratic society, or one of the defining characteristics of a democratic society, is how expansive this private domain is, the domain that no one has the right to interfere. Art becomes separate from religion, art becomes separate from state, art becomes essentially, the work of art becomes the work of an individual artist. Individualism in religion, in economics, in politics, in aesthetics, in morality, all are essential components of this modernity. Now, there have been two schools of thought in recent centuries in the debate about modernity. A dominant discourse, a Eurocentric discourse, has been that this all began in the West. It began somewhere in 12th, 13th century, and it reached a level of maturity during the Renaissance, the rise of the scientific revolution, the rise of Renaissance, the rise of Reformation, whatever name has been given to it, and then reached a new level of perfection, if you will, with the French Revolution and the developments after the French Revolution in the Age of Enlightenment. And all the characteristics that I said are part of this. But they said, and they continue to say this, and the they is a very wide range of people, some who are brilliant artists and scholars and historians and political theorists, and some who are racist and xenophobes, and everything in between, who say that modernity is essentially a Western phenomenon. It was created by the West. It befits the West's cultural, political, economical, even environmental, and certainly religious characteristics. It is interlinked with the Judeo-Christian tradition. It comes out of the Greco-Roman tradition and intermarriages with the Judeo-Christian tradition. It needs the moderate climes of Europe, and then it becomes what it becomes. And thus, to be modern essentially means to be Western, or at least emulate the Western model. And people inside Iran have been very much, many of some of Iran's most prominent political theorists, critics, artists, have said basically that that is really the case. That modernity in all its facets is Western. And thus, if we want to be modern, we follow the West. If you want to write a modern novel, you emulate the West. You don't have a tradition of writing fiction in Iran. Novel is a Western creation, as a genre is a Western creation. And thus, if you want to be a novelist, you need to learn your Persian language, but where you go to learn the work of the masters is in the Western novelist tradition. If you want theater, Iran doesn't have a theater tradition. If you want to become a modern theater director or a writer, you go and emulate the West. The most famous articulation of this, that Ghazal almost become a cliche, was made by someone called Taghizadeh, who famously said Iranians need to become in their bone and blood Western if they want to become modern. And the corollary to this is the idea that not only the West is what gave us all of this modernity, there is nothing in our tradition that can be useful to this modern project. As Hidayat famously said, Sadegh Hidayat famously said, the Iranian tradition, unless you go back to the pre-Islamic phase, is nothing but darkness, is nothing but despotism, is nothing but, he uses even more profane words, profanity-laced words, not profane, to describe it. And to me, that narrative is too flawed. And that narrative has been the result of Iranian scholars not really doing their work, Iranian artists not doing their work. That is, delving into our own tradition and trying to understand critically, but knowingly, whether there are elements in this tradition that we so easily dismiss that can be useful to this project of modernity. And I have written a series of articles, some books, there are a collection of these articles that basically have taken different texts from the past, particularly from the 10th to the 14th century, and have claimed that these point to a different narrative of modernity. They point to the idea that Iran's experimentation with some of these ideas, as sporadic as they were, never cohering into an organized movement, as they clearly were not, are indicative that our experience with modernity in this particular four centuries that we're talking about requires us to go back. Because if you go back, in my view, and in this book, in the view that I have offered with my co-author, Maryam Mirzadeh, if we go back, we'll find that many of these ideas that we think of as quintessentially Western are really not Western. They're not also purely Persian. They're human. They're part of a human effort to understand the world, create a better world, make sense of the world. And in many ways, in this period, there are some brilliant Iranian writers, poets, historians, social scientists, natural scientists, physicists, mathematicians, poets, who are every bit as modern and far ahead of the West as any modern philosopher, thinker, scientist we can imagine. This is not, and we keep saying this in this book, and I've said this everywhere that I've written about this, this is not to fall into the common reverse of the Eurocentric tradition that says everything comes from the West. There is the reverse of that, which is in a kind of an extreme self-righteous, almost arrogant view that says everything that is good in the world has come from Iran. Iran is the center of the world. Shahnameh famously or infamously said, "Honar nazd Iraniyan ast bas." Art is only in the hands, or wisdom is only in the hands of the Persians and nobody else. I'm not in any way suggesting that, nor am I in any way suggesting that in this very period that we're talking about, Saadi specifically, there aren't things that we must be very critical of. And if we want to create a modern character out of, for example, a Saadi, I've written about others, I've written about Bayhaqi, about how his historiography is really remarkably modern, remarkably empirical, remarkably critical. I've written about Nizami. So all of these are trying to suggest that a new reading of the past is our first now necessary step to a new kind of modernity. A new kind of modernity that doesn't fall prey to some of the temptations, and put temptations in quotation marks, that have been dominant in Iranian intellectual discourse over the last 100 years. One is that what, for the lack of a better word, has been called sort of the Westophilic tradition, this notion that everything comes from the West and thus we need to become like the West. The exact opposite of that is the view that everything that comes from the West is polluted. Everything that comes from the West, this has been most cogently argued by the religious opponents of modernity in recent years. In some of the writings of Ayatollah Khomeini, you can find this. Some of the writings of Mr. Khomeini, you can clearly find this. During the time of the Constitutional Revolution, you found this in Sheikh Fazlullah al-Nuri. It said, essentially, these modern ideas are part of a crusade. They're part of a Judeo-Christian tradition to undermine Islam and introduce into our culture ideas, phenomena, affinities that are alien to us. For example, the very idea of nation. Many of the Islamist thinkers from the 19th century till today say nationalism is a Western phenomenon. We believe in a spiritual community. We are part of a spiritual community. We are Muslims before we are anything else. Almost every aspect of this modern project is looked upon with a profound sense of distrust. It's looked upon as something essentially meant to undermine our identity, something meant to essentially debilitate Islam. So on the one side, you have the Westophiles, on the other side, you have the Westophobes who think everything that comes from the West is polluted, and that some of these ideas that might seem noble are actually intended to be a Trojan horse for undermining our identity. Our identity, in their view, is being Islamic. The reverse has been also part of the intellectual debate in Iran. What does it mean to be Iranian? You know, there are those who become so critical of Islam that say, like Hidayat, basically the most radical exponent of it, that says essentially Islam came and polluted this purity that it was Iran before Islam, and we now got to, we have to go back to that origin. This is in everything from beliefs to language, purifying the language of Arabic words. All of these are part of this, the same tradition. Or on the other side, you have those who say there was nothing in Iran before Islam came. The golden age of Iran is post-Islam, and being an Iranian essentially means being a Muslim. And both of these are the polarities of this intellectual debate. And next to them is this discussion of whence does modernity come from? And our argument in this book is that one of the most problematized concepts that stands at the core of modernity, which is humanism, contrary to the claims of the Westophiles and contrary to the claims of the Westophobes, is not a Western phenomenon and hasn't come to us from the West, hasn't come to us as a part of a colonial game to undermine us. It hasn't come as a part of a colonial package that tries to lie to us about what humanism is. Now, so with this theoretical background, I think you understand, I hope, why the project is both intellectually theoretically and historically important. Theoretically, it's important because I think it is part of a long tradition now, the last 50, 40 years, to question the Eurocentric notions that attributes everything to the West. It's part of the effort to scrutinize, or word they like in some of these theories, to interrogate our own texts, to understand them for what they are, and take from them what we can. One question one often is asked is, well, why do we need to look for these ideas? Why do we need to look for humanism in Saadi, for example? Why not just explicate what humanism is? Our answer is, first of all, we need to understand our past in order to have a more interesting, more successful, less despotic, less dogmatic future. But it's also important to free us from the temptations or the pressures of these two theoretical traditions. One that says humanism is Western, so you need to learn our ways and be like us. And one that says humanism is a Western trick, we need to reject it. We don't want it. We have our own moral values, and it has no place in it. There's no place for humanism. So that's kind of sort of the theoretical background, the historical context for this debate. In the case of Saadi, my first effort at this rereading began some 20 years ago in an article that I wrote for a journal that Professor Hishmeta Muayyed used to be part of the editorial board. I said that I have a special affinity, I have a special respect for Professor Muayyed. He was part of the editorial team of this Iran Shanasi, which is with Iran Name, particularly during the period that Professor Matini was the editor-in-chief. I think the most serious work of scholarship on Iranian culture and literature in Persian that the diaspora has produced. Kaveh is the only other thing. It was published 80 years ago that, in my view, is comparable in terms of its heft, its cultural heft, its in-depth understanding, its criticism. In that article, and the article is produced in this book, this short book. The book is about 150 pages. That article was about Saadi and the image of kings. One of the most common, in our view, misconceptions about Saadi is that he was a panegyrist of kings. This West of philic tradition in literary criticism, this tradition that says there's nothing good in Iran that needs to be appropriated, if you will, for the modern tradition, has been particularly harsh on Saadi. One manifestation of it is their harsh view on Saadi, dismissing Saadi as a panegyrist, dismissing Saadi as a maddah, dismissing Saadi as a wa'iz, as someone who engages and sermonizes, as someone who is craven in his praise for anyone who pays for him, and particularly the kings. And I decided about 20 years ago to read the first chapter of Gulistan. Saadi's two major works, Gulistan, is prose and poetry, and Bustan is poetry. He also has a lot of other poetical works. He also has a lot of works of satire, and give you a sense of how brilliant those works of satire were, how defined those works of satire were. Suffice it to say that even in 20th century, when they published the collected works of Saadi, they didn't dare put that material in there. I know many of you are students of Iranian literature. I'm sure you have read Obeid, and you know of Obeid. Saadi's satire is every bit as daring as Obeid's, and every bit as brilliant. It's not as much as Obeid as in terms of the quality of the quantity of his work, but it's truly brilliant. So in their perception, Saadi was even in approaching his work of satire. We quote some of the critics who say, it's really vulgar. We can't imagine how you can say these profanities because he talks about sex in a way that is very defined for his time. And more specifically, they say he's a panegyrist. And so when I read that first chapter of Golestan, which is on kings and on their behavior, I was truly shocked by how a closer reading of the text, an effort to read the line between the line, gives you an entirely different view of Saadi. Saadi, in our analysis, and in the analysis that I sort of began 20 years ago, and here we have developed it much, much, much further, is in fact a very serious critic of despotic kings. Saadi, ironically, in that book, is much more praiseful of the pre-Islamic Iranian kings. He has a profound affinity for what he thinks is a sense of justice in pre-Islamic Iranian monarchs. He mentions many of them in remarkably praiseworthy manner. And what he says, if you sort of deconstruct that first chapter and reconstruct it as a political vision. Lukács famously said, Gregory Lukács, very prominent critic in early 20th century, who became Marxist, but began his criticism before he turned Marxist. He said, you know, the work of criticism is like having an X-ray machine and putting an X-ray machine on a text and finding all the elements and all the structures and then reconstructing it into what it really tells us, aside from the frills. And once I tried to do that with Saadi, in the first chapter of Golestan, I found very different than the common perception. I found him actually to be a critic of kings. And furthermore, I found it to be full of guides in how to read the text. In other words, Saadi has constructed this kind of a brilliant text that has layers and layers of meanings. But he also tells us, almost literally, that look, I live in a bad time. You know, this is the time that Iran was under attack. Shiraz stayed relatively safe, but Iran was attacked. Tamerlan has come. There have been dynastic changes, some of new kings are absolutely brutal. The outside atmosphere is absolutely brutal. He tells us in almost literal terms. He says, I can't tell you everything I need to say. I need to count on your wisdom to search for the word within the word. Find where I have spoken metaphorically. Sometimes literally he says this. He says, don't pay attention to the dark images on a white page. See what lays behind and beneath and beyond that. And nevertheless, in spite of him writing in these metaphoric, beautiful metaphoric language, people have, in our view, taken to the most literal interpretations of him. And the book is, in essence, an effort, if that chapter was, if that early writing was one chapter, this is an effort to read and reread the entire opus of Saadi from the point of view of what does it tell us about his kind of paradigm on humanism. And our argument is that, in fact, Sa'di was a great humanist. He was a great humanist long before humanism became a catchword in Renaissance. He was a humanist before he even articulated the concept of humanism as a cogent concept. And the notion that you are a humanist or a modernist before there is modernity, that you're a Renaissance writer before there was the concept of Renaissance, is not strange. The first time people, and the scholar talks about 15th, 16th century Florence as the age of Renaissance, as a civilization of Renaissance, is in 19th century, it's Burckhardt. We found an earlier reference to the word Renaissance, but it's literally meant as a Renaissance. Vasari refers to it in an article. I found it in a reference by Stephen Greenblatt. But it's Burckhardt who says there was something happening here that together gels into something, a civilization that we should call Renaissance. But people who were doing Renaissance from Shakespeare to Michelangelo didn't think of themselves as advocates of modernity. So Sa'di, although he never uses the word modernity, doesn't even know that it exists, comes very close in many aspects of what we would think as a humanist. In other words, an advocate of a kind of a modern society, at the center of which stands an individual, a human being who thinks for herself and himself. And I said for herself and himself, again, with careful choice of words, because one of the other things that is famously, commonly, and in our view, one-sidedly said about Sa'di is that he was also a misogynist. Sa'di has some very bad poetry about a woman. And people have taken those poems, rightly criticized them for it, but forgot to look at the others and say, in the context of these other characteristics, while we should criticize his misogyny here, we should praise his revolutionary openness to the idea that women are absolutely equal to men. And not only they're absolutely equal to men in their rational faculties, I'm talking about someone 800 years ago, they're absolutely equal to men in what they can expect of a relationship with their husbands. They are equal in their expectation of sexual satisfaction. He says that long before Madame Bovary came on the scene, long before all the traditions that says, if a woman is accused of something, let's find what the context was. Sa'di says in his poetry and in some of the stories that if a woman is unhappy, if a woman commits quote unquote adultery, doesn't use the word adultery, it's wrong to just point the finger at the woman. You need to understand. Sa'di has more than probably any other poet, certainly is one of the few Persian poets who has praised woman. Sa'di has many panegyrics. We accept that. But we also say, based on studies that others have done, that Sa'di is one of the few people who has written panegyrics about woman. And very crucially, he hasn't praised woman for quote unquote their beauty, for becoming being a docile wife, being a good procreator of children. No, he praises them for their wisdom, for their justice. In one place, he praises a woman to be more just than the prophet of Islam. We quote the entire part of the poem. So like Shakespeare, who has a lot of lines that are odious in terms of the image of woman. But he also has several plays whose central characteristic, the title characteristic, is a woman. And he has a lot of wonderful ideas about how we should approach this. We, in reading Shakespeare, we don't pick only those lines. Some people do, but historiography, literary criticism, the likes of Stephen Greenblatt or the likes, don't just pick on one aspect. Greenblatt has a very interesting, Stephen Greenblatt, I don't know whether some of you know his work, he's one of the sort of main theorists for new historicism. He says, if you read Shakespeare carefully, it's very difficult to sometimes pinpoint whether Shakespeare is someone who contributes to the consolidation of the monarchy or someone who is a critic of the monarchy, someone who is an advocate of conformity or someone who is an advocate of rebellion. We don't even really know, as we quote in the book, we don't really know what Shakespeare's faith was. Was he a Catholic? Was he a Protestant? Was he an Anglican? Was he a Gnostic? All of these arguments have been made, some of them very convincingly. The same level of doubt and constant scrutiny must be applied to Sa'di. And Sa'di is important because he is a central element of the canon. If there is something called the West Iranian canon, Sa'di, very much like Shakespeare, stands at its center. We quote Harold Bloom, who passed away recently. We quote him with some skepticism. Harold Bloom says Sa'di invests in Shakespeare, Freudian slip. The Shakespeare invented humanism. The book is called Sa'di and the Invention of the Human. And he says he is so central to the canon that everything that comes before him and all, everything that comes after him is in some ways prefigured in him. That, in our view, is the centrality of Sa'di. Many people, again, many of you are students of literature, many people have talked about the singular significance of language in Iranian culture, in Iranian cultural identity, in Iranian cultural history. How Iranians took Islam but didn't take Arabic and maintained their Persian language and turned it into a kind of a bastion of resistance, if you will. And almost everyone praises Ferdowsi for his remarkable work in preserving the language. But many historians of the Persian language, many, and we quote some of them, say that Sa'di's role is at least as significant as Ferdowsi in preserving this language, in preserving the Persian sense of identity. I've already talked about 35 minutes, so let me talk another 10 minutes maybe, and then we'll stop. Is that okay, Mr. Rafiei?
Yes, okay. Absolutely.
Okay. If you want me to stop here, I can, but if I can go another 10 minutes.
Sure, you can go another 10 minutes.
That's yeah. We talk about a language, again, to go back to what one of my earlier comments was, that when we talk about the novel, for example, the dominant view has been, dominant view of critics has been, that the novel is essentially a Western creation. And Iranians, if they want to become novelists, they must follow that path. Professor Beard has written a brilliant book about Sadr-e Hidayat, The Blind Isle, as a Western novel. I've written a review of it and argued why I think it needs to be a question. But it's a very learned account of this very dominant theory that the novel is a Western creation. So what we did is talk about what do we understand by the novel? What are the characteristics of the novel? What are the characteristics of a novelistic language? If you want to become a novelist, what do you need? There are certain things that novel seems to be consisting of. We quote some Russian critics who are considered to be some of the best critics of the novel. Novel, it's said, it needs to be dialogical. Novel is a form of a dialogue. Novel is a dialogue between the art, the writer, and the reality, between us and the text, between the people within the world created by the novelist. Sometimes it is the dialogue inside the mind of a person. You know, you begin with the Western tradition, with Don Quixote, come to Joyce, which half of the book is the internal dialogue. So dialogue is central to the novel. And dialogue is an important part of humanism, because humanism epistemologically is founded on the idea that none of us have access to absolute truth. We need to find a truth. I'm not talking about the post-truth of the Donald Trump era. This ain't talking about a post-truth era. It's talking about the contingency of truth and the need to constantly search it and constantly refine it and constantly be open to the idea that we need to change our conceptions of what the truth is. And that process can only come with a dialogue. A sermon is the opposite of a dialogical thinking. A sermon is when someone, thinks she or he has an absolute claim to some truth, and it is her or his responsibility to impart to us, as docile readers, as docile recipients of this usually heavenly wisdom. In Marxism, it's not heavenly wisdom, it's historical wisdom. In empiricism, it's scientific wisdom. They need to impart to us these absolute truth, and you need to follow it. The novel is about a dialogue. Let's converse. Let's look at each other, not from the pulpit or somewhere high up, but let's sit and eye level, and let's have a dialogue, let's have a discussion. Let's look at these things in different aspects. Let's be humble about our claim to truth. And we have argued here, and I can give you several examples, of how profoundly dialogical Sa'di is. The Sa'di that is considered Sa'di of Wa'iz, this is not to say that he wasn't profoundly religious. People's profound religiosity, whatever they might be, has nothing to do with what the text can tell us. The text tells us of a dialogical imagination. The text is, contrary to what almost all the critics have said, is not about shaping us into a docile recipients of his truth, quote unquote, absolute truth. He repeatedly says, I'm giving you my version of the truth, but my own version of the truth has changed. I've traveled 30 years around the world, and what I thought was true then is no longer the truth now. And he is very averse, because we live in an age where religious ideas and religious identity has become more central. He is also very averse, interestingly, to the idea of Muslims thinking of themselves as or anybody else, not just Muslims, but he was talking to a Muslim society, of having a privileged purchase on divine wisdom. He says repeatedly, who are you to think your ethics is better than a Hindu? Who are you to think your ethics is better than a Jew? There are places that his poetry is profoundly, shamefully anti-Semitic. But there are also equal number of places where he says to his Muslim brethren and sisters, who are you to think you're better than? Who are you to decide how the way to salvation can be crossed. People need to have their own pathways. People need to find their own way to this. And the way is with dialogue. The way is with creating minds that are invited to create the meaning of the text. That's why we think he is a humanist, both in his method, in his methodology, in the simplicity, brilliance, pith, parsimony, but also metaphoric density of his language. You can let Saadi wash over you and you'll enjoy it. The more you delve into it, the more you uncover its complexities, and the more you become an active citizen of that republic, which is the republic of humanism, a republic of thinking critically, engage individuals, man and woman, in a search for truth. There are other aspects of the Saadi that we have talked about this in this book. If you want me, I can talk about it in the question and answer period. There is an aspect of a controversial aspect of Saadi about his writing on love of boys, his relationship with boys. I can give you what our reading of it is. But the core of our argument is what I tried to argue, that contrary to the dominant perception, Saadi is someone who we need to read and reread to get from him the elements of this, if you will, indigenous, local efforts at a humanism and thus as at a modernity. I've gone a little too long, so I'm now open to having a dialogue rather than me giving you a sermon.
Thank you so much, Dr. Milani. And thank you for to our participants for engaging and asking some very thoughtful, insightful questions. This is really important work, especially now. There's so much tumult and dysfunction in the world. And with these fundamental, there are these fundamental exercises and kind of questions that we're looking for wisdom in these sages of old or writers of old. And I imagine it must be a very exhilarating project to go and discover these gems, especially in the works of one like Saadi Shirazi. I wanted to thank you again, Dr. Milani, on behalf of the MESA Student Association at the University of Chicago. Thank you so much for accepting our invitation to present. Thank you to all of the participants for your time and for coming to join us this evening. Wanted to just mention again really quick, we will have another lecture next week with Professor Michael Cooperson from UCLA. He'll be speaking about his recent English translation of the famed Maqamat of Hariri. So we hope to see many of you there next week as well. Thank you again, Professor Milani.
Thank you very much for the invitation. It was absolutely a pleasure. Thank you.
Thank you.